Yeah. Terrific night of basketball. This Lipscomb team is really good. They're really disciplined. They somehow managed to push the ball really hard in transition, and then grind it out in half court, and that's a hard thing to put together. And they're incredibly well coached. Lenny's been doing a great job for a long time. He's a terrific coach. You can see it. I don't know if we'll play teams that are this committed and disciplined to the way they play very much, and so it posed a real challenge. I thought our guys were great. I thought they really competed, and for most part, I thought we had pretty good results.
Yeah, Mark, I wonder, with a team this old, what was your anxiety level like this week in terms of a letdown after such an emotional game with Duke?
You know, it's interesting. We had this conversation earlier today with the broadcast team, but we don't stress, like we don't get nervous, we don't worry, because it doesn't actually work. Sometimes we think if teams have a letdown after a big win, that it's because like, oh man, if the coach had just thought about the possibility of being a letdown and prepared his team for no letdown, it wouldn't happen. And what happens is we all just overkill, right? We just start pushing that narrative so hard with our teams. And so we don't actually do it at all. We're gonna always be focused on what we need to do. And so we really work hard. I mean, it's human nature to worry about that a little bit, but we really work hard to focus on what we are trying to do. Our guys are really hungry to get better. We're hungry to become a great team. We don't have a lot of time to do it. And so the last game was over, and it was kind of under like, how can we get better? How can we get better? That's the only thing we talk about. And the biology of that, actually the neuroscience of that is 100% in support of that, right? We're not going to focus on what we don't want to have happen. We're going to focus on what we do want to have happen. And our guys have received that really well. So we didn't spend much time on it at all, and we won't. That's not the way we do it. That doesn't mean we won't ever have bad results. It just means that we're going to always focus on what we're trying to do, and we're going to try and be laser focused on that. We're not going to spend a lot of time thinking about what we do not want to have happen.
Mark, I know you obviously had no offensive concerns with Jackson after the Duke game, but can you just speak to how much he's grown over the past 2.5 years since you've known him? And is he a guy that maybe you had to 2 years ago step in and say something to after a game like that where you just don't worry about it now?
I'm so impressed with Jackson Robinson. What's really interesting is he had a terrific game against Duke. That's the weird part, is he actually played really well. He came up with massive defensive stops down the stretch. They were game-determining stops that we really needed. There's a couple things that we're really impressed about Jackson, his growth and his maturity, is that he wasn't having a huge impact on the game in the scorebook offensively, although he was having a huge impact gravity-wise, but it wasn't the payoff of the scorebook and all the things. And he refused to let that drain his defensive intensity and his energy towards his team. Some of my favorite pictures coming out of that game, we get all these pictures coming at us, and it's like Jackson Robinson, Andrew Carr gets an N1, and Jax is like the first guy to be there, just like, screaming, and his veins are popping on his neck, and every bit of emotion's there, and the ability that he has as a veteran player to like stay in the moment in the game and care about his teammates and still perform at a great level defensively, even when he's not putting up 20 or 30, is a massive, it's what you dream about coaching, right? It's gonna serve him well this year. It's gonna serve him great in the NBA. And it's been really inspiring to be able to witness his growth. I don't know how many times we're gonna get to coach players for 3 years anymore, but it's been unbelievable to be able to coach him for two years and four games, and I love it. I'm really proud of him.
Coach, Kobe Brea continues to shoot the ball at an incredible numbers, but he does other things such as 7 rebounds tonight, continues to rebound the ball. Is there any other part of his game that you would like to unlock, and do you continue to expect him to shoot at such an amazing clip.
Yeah, I thought he was great on the glass tonight. It wasn't just 7 rebounds, but it was challenge rebounds. It was physical rebounds. I was really proud of him for that. He ended up with some switch mismatches that he handled really well. I still think he's got a huge amount of game in his tank on the defensive end and isolation, handling guys one-on-one. He actually, Kobe's interesting because sometimes my eyes trick me, and at the end of the game, he's actually got a better defensive package than I thought I saw. So with him, I always have to go back to the numbers to just check with my eyes right now as I'm learning him as a defensive player. I also think he's got a chance to be a terrific playmaker. He's still learning to get off 2 feet. He had one opportunity where he shot fake and drove baseline right in front of our bench, where he could see the bottom kind of was there, and he bailed out of it, and I actually have the confidence in him. I'd love him to carve out space, get his shoulder into the hips that he just turned, carve out some space, and get all the way to 2 feet, because he's really good in there. And so I'd like him to grow in that sense about being able to probe more downhill, more confidently, more often while creating space. And I'd like him to continue to be a really, really dangerous, huge energy cutter. He probably doesn't manufacture as much as he can yet. He's such a lethal shooter, and teams are going to overplay more, and he can really kill teams as a cutter, and that's a place in this game where he's growing. So there's a lot of growth for him, but man, he's putting together a pretty fun product, right? It's pretty fun. It's hard. Like we talked about it. Lipscomb came in having played 34 possessions of zone at a 0.511 points per possession. That's ridiculous, guys. That's so good. And so they kind of saved it and went to it in the second half. And then it's like you got Kobe Bryant running around shooting threes. And it's like, we can't do that. So I think we're almost 2 points per possession, over 2 points per possession against the zone. And he just is he's a fun player to coach. He's a beautiful human being.
Coach, other coach for Lipscomb tonight talked about how if Butler's hitting the shots that he's hitting, he said they're going to be unstoppable. He said we tried to play off a little bit, and we realized we couldn't do that, and then you overplay and leaves other guys open. He said when those guards are playing like that, including Butler, so what does it do when Lamont is hitting shots like he was tonight?
Well, we don't spend the time relying on guys making shots. We rely on them taking them. Like, I'll be honest, we were good in a lot of areas on the stat sheet, but we only got up 25 threes. That's just not us. That's not who we're supposed to be. But Lamont is going to be that way all year. Like, he's unbelievably solid. If you notice, like, he shot the ball great all camp for us. He shot it all summer great. He's a terrific shooter, especially when, what he's doing now so well is when guys go under ball screens, he's not rushed. He's coming off hard, and then he's stopping, and he's really finding his balance. And he knows right now in our scheme, he knows that if he stops and gets out of balance to shoot it and they close out late, he can play a rifle game. And he's devastating in the rifle game, especially when someone's closed, because now they're not, they're out of the position that they've tried to be in the scout, right? So it actually distorts everything you've tried to prep in a scout coming to him, that he can do that play behind, get his balance, and if you close, he goes rifle game and ends up getting downhill. So he's very confident with that package. He's always got it at his disposal. He's getting better and better at it. I was actually really pleased with him actually getting downhill in the transition and winning the gap. That was a huge thing. This is a good Steelers team, and I thought he made two incredible plays downhill that I thought were really special where he protected the ball.
Come all the way to the back.
Hey, Mark, back here. When you hear that you're the first Kentucky team to make 10 or more threes in each of your four games in a regular season in the whole history of the school, how does that make you feel, one? And then two, where do you see improvements needed in three-point shooting so far this season?
Well, when you say that, the first thing, I'm disappointed. How did we not make 10 threes a game in 96? Like, what are we doing, guys? I'm gonna call the boys and be like, boys, what were we doing? So that's my first reaction. Second reaction is that's great. We're gonna have some games where we don't make 10 threes. I'm worried about the attempts, right? We gotta keep pushing the attempts. I'm nitpicking because our guys played terrific tonight. I thought they were great, but we only had 10 assists. That's not us. The ball, give credit to Lipscomb. They were really out of help a lot in this game, and so it ended up with a lot of guys having open shots, where they didn't have to earn it for each other. It was just standing there open, and we shot 48% from three, so I just like to get more of them. But I'm proud of that. I mean, it's a really important part of our
of our team. I would be more excited if we were at 35 three-point attempts a game, but I'll take the 10 makes for sure.
Kerry. Mark, back here. You talk about, I guess, only 10 assists, but you only had 8 turnovers, yeah. And I think for a while in the second half you didn't have any. What is it about the discipline with a team like that, with the style you play and trying to push it, especially your shooting threes?
Yeah. I mean, the turnovers is a massive issue for us. I think we had 6. We have 6 or 7 in the first half. I think we had 6, right? And that was not, we weren't really pleased about that, but I thought in the second half we were much, much better. You know, turnover game is just massively important the way we play. We believe that the more aggressive we are, the more attack mode we are, the less turnovers we're going to have. And then the concepts that we've talked about all together several times about 2 hands, 2 feet and driving lines and KDAs and all the concepts that we focus on, simple plays, winning gaps was a huge point of emphasis tonight. If you watch the Western Kentucky game, these guys were terrorizing Western Kentucky on drives by getting gap rake steals, right? And so that's a huge point of emphasis for our guys, and they did that really, really well. So, you know, us being low on the turnover space is
Marco here. Well, actually, this part isn't a question, but Bucknell being the Bison, and then tonight they're the Bison, so it's another similarity there. But going back to Lamont and his shooting, you know, he has so many elite skills, but if you just look on paper, his three-point shooting has never been what you call an elite skill.
Yeah.
So kind of a two-part question is, one, are the numbers there deceiving? Do you think he can, you know, eventually become an elite three-point shooter? Two, is there a certain percentage maybe that you're hoping that he reaches?
Yeah, no, he is an elite level shooter. He's, listen, and please, you know, don't get me in trouble for what I'm saying, because Dutch is one of the great coaches in all of college basketball, and Lamont's run at San Diego State was brilliant. I mean, he couldn't have been any better. They couldn't have been any better. I mean, it was a national championship game. But Lamont's going to be a way better shooter in our system because we shoot. That's what we do. It's a different style. Our emphases are different. Doesn't mean they're better or worse. It's just different. Lamont's an elite level shooter. I mean, Lamont shot it. I mean, he shot it great all summer. He's shooting great this season. You know, I have every expectation that he's going to continue to shoot it great. He actually finishes every shot. His balance is terrific. He's judicial about the ones that he takes. He works hard to get his feet before his hands, you know, all the concepts that we care about in shooting, he shoots it great. So he's a dangerous guy that way. And you know, it makes the game easier for us when people go under on him because he's going to make shots and he's also going to be really smart about it. So I don't, you know, I mean, it's just who he is. It's not, there's no prognosticating. That's just who he is as a player. He's really good.
We'll finish with back here. Sorry. Hi, Mark. Before this game, you mentioned that you wanted to focus a little bit on defense, and I was just wondering what you saw tonight that you liked, what you think you still need to improve on.
Yeah, so there were some things I loved in the first half. First of all, we kept him under 39%, barely. We tried desperately to get him over 39% in the last 5 minutes, but we hung in there and got him to 38.8% field goal percentage. That's really important. That's our marker, so I think we're 4 for 4, I think, on that stat. I thought we were there on the catch the whole night really well, minus the pick and pop situations with their 5-man, which was kind of a calculated decision on our part. It worked in our favor. So I was happy about challenging shots for sure. Both inside the three and outside. I was really proud of us in the first half. We only gave up 1 backdoor, and this is a great cutting team. They're excellent. They're almost 10%. It's either 9 or 11% of their possessions are cuts, which is really high, guys. You don't see that a lot, and it's not dunker spot cuts. This is like real, real cuts. In that way, they're similar to us. And we only gave up 1 in the entire first half. I was really proud of that. And our guys were actually able to handle, you know, they punish you because their scheme is you either have to race through handoffs and ball screens to get over top, or if you try and beat them to it, then it's a backdoor situation. Our guys' train tracks concepts were great tonight in the first half. I was really proud of that. We only gave up 3 offensive rebounds in the first half, although they were only sending 1 guy, but still, that's a good number for us. So there's a lot to be really pleased about on the defensive end. I'd like us to you know, there we had some stretches in the second half where you know, we weren't as laser focused as we want to be. I'd like us to really develop a standard where it doesn't matter what time or score is, that we are locked in on that. It doesn't matter who's on the floor, we're locked in defensively the whole time. But I, for the most part, I'm really proud of the guys' defensive effort tonight.